shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you
perfector. Amen. Whoa.
nothing else satisfies, only you, Lord. You are my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence, my sword for the fight. You are my dignity, you're my delight. You're my sole shelter, and you're my high. Come raise me heavenward, oh power of my power.
The Word of God calls us to keep our eyes on Jesus. We do that, Lord.
Who has held the oceans in his hands? Who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore Him. Who has given counsel to the Lord? Who can question His words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all His wondrous deeds? Behold our God seated on His throne. Come, let us adore. Felt the nails upon His hand, bearing all the guilt of sinful man. God eternal, humble to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. Adore Him. Behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come, let us adore Him. Oh, and You will reign forever. You thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, oh. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry.
Just praise him, church. Not just in your hearts. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks through our lips. So just lift up your voice and praise him and worship him. Join in with the angels that they cry holy. Father, we thank you that through new birth, we acquire a hunger to know your word. And then in concert with the Holy Spirit, being baptized in his fullness, he kindles within us a desire to know the God of the word. To hallelujah. And Father, your word in Hebrews 6, verse 9 says, but beloved, we are confident of better things concerning you. Better things concerning you. Those things that accompany this greatest salvation that we have. That this hope, through faith, hope connects that which is in the natural to that which is in the eternal. And in this hope, we have, it's an anchor, it's a substance of things hoped for. But it's an anchor in our soul, both sure and steadfast, which compels us. Invites us, we follow the Savior, which we enter the presence behind the veil. Not just a geographical place beyond the veil, but where we have an encounter with you, where we enter into your presence. And Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would be upon every soul in this room. Every lover of your word, to enter into that presence and to become that lover of the God of the word, to which we join and we sing, holy, holy, holy forever. This great salvation. Great salvation. That is my word of praise to you, Lord. Our adoration to you. In thy presence, we desire to be continually in thy presence. Father, we pray also that that awakening, that kindling of the Spirit would be stirred up, not just at Harvest Fellowship, not just in the leadership, although at Life Assembly we pray for Pastor Dave, but that he too would become a contagion to his congregation, to desire to enter into that presence behind the veil. We pray for Pastor John. Take him be above a ceiling, that there is no ceiling over him anymore in his apprenticeship ministry, and that he too takes his students, his people of whom he's ministering to, that they break free where there is no ceiling that separates them from you and your presence. We lift up Pastor Bill Arvin and Reed Ministries and all the workers within, not just here on stateside, but over in Eastern Europe. We pray the same for Pastor Eber and Melissa, that they too would be like people of faith, like Abraham, leading to faith, receiving promise of this ultimate destination, your presence beyond the veil. Father, we lift up those who are struggling with illness and disease, that they too would have breakthrough in thy holy presence. We pray for Patty and Susie, and Pastor Dan's brother Tim, Lori, Londa's sister, Trisha and Brenda's sister Melanie, our dear friends Mark Hansen, Martha Roth, Greg Rowling's dad, mom, and brother, for Becky Arvin. We pray that this greatest salvation can be experienced here in the world. Bring healing upon them. And we lift up Pastor Dan. We pray that he too, that your Holy Spirit would flow through him. He's planned his paths in this pulpit today. But that you, Lord, and your Holy Spirit would guide his steps. That eternal words would be dropped into the hearts, minds, and ultimately spirits of every person seated here today. God, we love you, Lord. We love you, Father. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Holy Spirit. Have thine own way with us this day. And for those who are struggling, maybe they've sat down. Maybe it feels like the fire has gone out. Revive their hearts. Give them burning hearts, as in the day of their salvation. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Morning, church. Aaron, I'm not used to you finishing. Did the nickel run out? Morning, everyone. Morning, folks at home, whether you're watching us live or after the fact. God still moves. My name is Mick Mayhew. I'm one of the elders here at Harvest Fellowship. And if you're welcome, we want to welcome you and have you please take a minute to fill out our online connection card at harvestmn.com. It's the one time you can use it. No, I guess you can use your phone during the sermon with searching the verses that Pastor Dan will have us looking up. I know of one pastor, he misses the days of hearing pages rattling, so he was suggesting inventing an app for people, their Bible app that has pages turning, you know, wrestling. It's so encouraging to a pastor, isn't it, Dan, to hear that? All right. Never mind. Pardon that bunny trail. Click the connection button and fill out the form. You can also sign up here for our weekly newsletter called Harvest News. If you prefer to fill it out by hand, there are hard copies in the seat pockets in front of you with pens. So help yourself and fill them out and drop them off at both doors on your way out, which is also where the tithe and offering goes. So just want to thank everybody for their faithful giving. As we, in the leadership, endeavor to make sure that the investments are directly and solely going to the things in the work of God. So you can be confident of that. International Day potluck is today at 11:30 in the gymnasium. So the international community is coming to Sauk Rapids, Minnesota. All are invited to attend, whether or not you've signed up to bring an ethnic entree. So this is This is a time of fellowship with Harvest Español, right? Yep, so our sister church. This Saturday, October 26th, a group of Harvest from Harvest will be going out to our neighbors to show the love of Christ by giving away 9-volt smoke detector replacement batteries. If you are interested, yeah, you're the charge, you're the battery charge. Amen? If you're interested in being a part of this evangelism activity, come to Harvest at 11 a.m. on the 26th, this Saturday. At this time, I'd like to ask one of our missionaries with YWAM, Faith Wiebolt is here. I did not know that. All right. Hey, sis. Oh, so good to see you. I have something for you.
Thank you. Good morning, church. How are you guys doing? Good. So as some of you know me, my name is Faith Wiebolt, and I have had the pleasure of calling Harvest my home church since I was a little girl. And so I'm here to share with you today a little bit about the ministry that I've been doing for the last 3 years in Ensenada, Mexico with YWAM. So, for those of you who don't know, YWAM stands for Youth with a Mission. It was started in 1960. It's an international, interdenominational ministry, and there is currently 1,200 locations for YWAM in the world, which is amazing. And there's also 18,000 volunteers who serve with YWAM throughout the world. And YWAM's mission statement is to know God and to make him known. So they do this through a multiple different avenues of ministry, but the three main categories are through mercy ministries. So I don't know if I have a slideshow at all, maybe. But there's some pictures on this slideshow, if it gets working, of different mercy ministries that we do in Ensenada, Mexico. There's building homes for families who don't have them, working with the homeless, going to orphanages, things like that. And then the next avenue of ministry is training. So YWAM is committed to training young people to be missionaries. So the University of the Nations is a ministry that they have where you can take a school from 3 months to a 9-month school focused on discipleship, Bible training, counseling, many different things. And then the last avenue of ministry is evangelism. So YWAM is committed to doing evangelism and sending out teams with these schools for about 2 months to a different country to share the gospel, or even doing like local ministry in the area, partnering with the local church. So as I shared with you, I've been in Ensenada for the last 3 years as a missionary, which is crazy. It's gone by very, very fast. And now I'm excited to share with you that the Lord's actually been moving me in a new direction, and I'm going to be serving with YWAM in a new location in Italy. And this starts in January that I'll be going there. And actually, the Lord began to lay Europe and Italy on my heart when I was in Mexico. So we had a team of about 60 students coming to Ensenada to do ministry. And these students were a little different than normal. Most of them were atheists or agnostic, and they were from the United Kingdom. So as you can imagine, it was a little different than normal. These students were pretty closed off at the beginning of the week. But as we started to share our testimonies and start to spend time with them and get to be with them, by the end of the week, 1/3 of them decided to give their life to Christ, which was incredible, so beautiful. And another large portion of them decided that they were more interested in God than they ever had been. And one girl that I got to meet, she kind of became my buddy, and we spent a lot of time together. She asked me all these questions about God, what it means to follow the Lord, what it means to be a Christian. And the Lord showed me through her something I never thought about before. So I had seen a lot of poverty, economic poverty in my life, but I had never thought about the aspect of spiritual poverty. That this girl, though she had everything, she had no understanding of who God was. And that really, really broke my heart. And the Lord showed me that his heart breaks for those both in economic poverty and in spiritual poverty. So the base that I'm going to be serving with in Italy is focused on seeing revival happen within Europe and Italy. A lot of the same things are true for the youth in Italy, that most of them are agnostic or atheists. Maybe their parents grew up knowing about God, but to them, God is only a religion. And so their focus is to see those youth encounter the true living God. The ministries in Italy are unique to Italian culture, seeking to engage the lost through avenues that would be normal to them. So some of the focuses are on Bible training, hospitality as a way to evangelism, and using art, music, and creativity as a way to engage people with the gospel. So I'm excited to be going to Italy. I'll be leaving in January, so I'll be here this whole fall, and I would really love to get connected with you. If you are interested in hearing more about this ministry, just let me know. I'll be around after service. I also have different prayer cards, so if you're interested and you want to be praying for Italy, praying for this ministry, take a prayer card and put it on your refrigerator. And I just wanted to thank Harvest so much for your continuous support these last 3 years and your partnership with me, sharing the gospel in Ensenada. And I just wanted to invite you, if you are interested in talking with me, I'm looking for prayer partners and financial supporters. And I just wanted to thank you guys so much for your time this morning, and thank you for your love as my church family. Bless you guys.
Thank you, Faith. Yeah, not only is she a solid, steadfast woman of God, she's also one of Harvest's sweethearts. Amen? A team from Harvest is leaving tomorrow for Asheville, North Carolina, to support a church in the center of the hurricane disaster, also called Fellowship Asheville. If you're part of that team, please come up so that we can pray over you. I'd also like to invite the elders up too.
Hey, brother. Come on in. Are you going?
I'm going.
Okay. Are you going? Okay.
Hey, Phil. Where are you?
Thank you, Lord, for laying this mission on the heart of these folks. Lord, we just pray that, first of all, you give them safety as they travel down there, supply them all their needs. Pray that as they help, Lord, you will multiply their efforts, multiply the loaves and the fishes that are offered here, Lord. And once again, we just ask that you'd be a tremendous blessing and just a very practical help. And as they work with the youth and the children's ministries, we just expect a great blessing, and we ask for a great blessing in your name, Jesus' name. Amen. What a great last-minute team that God put together, huh?
Amen. Yes. Amen. Thanks, everyone. So let's. And when do you guys return? You leave tomorrow, and return.
Next Sunday, Monday.
Okay, so about a week.
Yep.
All right. Well, we'll be lifting you guys up in prayer. And as I mentioned, tithes and offerings, if you want to check out our website, harvestmn.com, you can find out about it there. And also you can go through Harvest News, the Vanco mobile app on your phone, and you can make a gift there. Pastor Dan, oh, you're already there. Hey, everybody, let's stand. Extend your hands towards this brother. Let's just bless him. Father, we do lift up Dan to you. We pray that a peace would come upon him beyond expectation. We pray that a peace of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit would come upon this room in ways we've all never experienced before. Bless him now, Lord, as he ministers to you, and as we minister to him by just praying amen over him, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you want this?
Morning, everyone. It's good to see your smiling faces. The pastor preached a very strong sermon about sin one Sunday morning. After the service, one of the church leaders followed him into his office to talk to him. "Pastor," he said, "I don't think you should be talking as strongly as you do about sin, because it's just going to cause our people to feel bad about themselves, and then they'll just stop coming to church." The pastor took a small bottle down from his bookshelf and, showing it to the church leader, said, "Do you see the label? It says strychnine. And underneath it, in bold red letters, the word poison. By asking me not to talk so strongly about sin, you are in essence suggesting that I change the label on this bottle. Suppose I do that. Suppose I paste over it a sticker with the words vanilla extract. Do you see what might happen? Someone might actually use it, not knowing the danger involved, and they may even die as a result." And then he finished with these really profound words. He said, "So it is with sin. The milder you make your label, the more dangerous you make your poison." Isn't that a good story? As Jamie and Adam did with a variety of urban legends on the Discovery Channel's very popular show, Mythbusters, we are this morning going to debunk or bust three myths about sin to make sure that the label we put on it reflects its true danger, okay? So turn in your Bibles, if you have them with you, to Joshua 7. Put your finger on verse 10. That's where we'll start. If you don't have a Bible, please just raise your hand. Someone will give you one so that you can follow along when we read that passage together. And as you're looking up that passage, let me give you some background information to serve as our context. After the people of Israel had made the seventh circle around the city of Jericho on the seventh day of their campaign, I'm sure you all remember the story, and after the priests had blown their trumpets, Joshua said to the nation of Israel, and this goes back to Joshua 6, verses 16 and 17, "Shout! For the Lord has given you the city, but the city and everything in it are set apart to the Lord for destruction." He then went on to warn the people to not take any of the city's riches for themselves, but to leave everything behind. Verse 18 of chapter 6, "Keep yourselves from the things set apart, or you will be set apart for destruction. If you take any of those things, you will set apart the camp of Israel for destruction and bring disaster on it." And so, verse 20 of chapter 6, when they heard the blast of the trumpet, the people gave a great shout and the wall collapsed. The people advanced into the city, each man straight ahead, and they captured the city. That's the city of Jericho. Not long after that victory, Joshua sent spies to scope out the next city in line, that is the city of Ai. The spies returned and said that Ai was weak and could be defeated with only a few men, so Joshua sent a small battalion of only 3,000 to take it. But things didn't turn out as planned. The men of Ai killed 36 Israelites, sending the rest of them to hastily retreat for their very lives. Joshua was heartbroken by the news. The scripture says he tore his clothes and he fell to the earth on his face in front of the Ark of the Covenant, and he cried out to God. This is chapter 7, verses 7 through 9, the two verses that precede our passage. "Oh, Lord God, why did you ever bring these people across the Jordan to hand us over to the Amorites for our destruction? If only we had been content to remain on the other side of the Jordan. What can I say, Lord, now that Israel has turned its back and run from its enemies? When the Canaanites and all who live in the land hear about this, they will surround us and wipe out your name from the earth. Then what will you do about your great name? And how God answers Joshua, as where we'll pick up on the story. So Joshua chapter 7, we're going to begin in verse 10, and I'm going to read through the rest of that chapter. Joshua 7, 10, the Lord then said to Joshua, "Stand up. Why are you on the ground? Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant that I appointed for them. They have taken some of what was set apart. They have stolen, deceived, and put the things with their own belongings. This is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies. They will turn their backs and run from their enemies because they have been set apart for destruction. I will no longer be with you unless you remove from what you remove from you what is set apart. Go and consecrate the people. Tell them to consecrate themselves for tomorrow, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. There are things that are set apart among you, Israel. You will not be able to stand against your enemies until you remove what is set apart. In the morning, you must present yourself tribe by tribe. The tribe the Lord selects is to come forward clan by clan. The clan the Lord selects is to come forward family by family. The family the Lord selects is to come forward man by man. The one who is caught with the things set apart must be burned, along with everything he has, because he's violated the Lord's covenant and committed an outrage in Israel. Verse 16. Joshua got up early the next morning. He had Israel come forward tribe by tribe, and the tribe of Judah was selected. He had the clans of Judah come forward, and the Zerahite clan was selected. He had the Zerahite clan come forward by the heads of families, and Zabdi was selected. He then had Zabdi's family come forward man by man, and Achan, son of Carmi, son of Zabdi, son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, was selected. So Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, and make a confession to him. I urge you, tell me what you have done. Don't hide anything from me." Achan replied to Joshua, "It is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. This is what I did. When I saw among the spoils a beautiful cloak from Babylon, 200 silver shekels and a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and I took them. You can see for yourself. They're concealed in the ground inside my tent with the money under the cloak." So Joshua sent messengers who ran to the tent. There was the cloak concealed in his tent with the money underneath. They took the things from inside the tent, brought them to Joshua and all the Israelites, and spread them out in the Lord's presence. Then Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, son of Zerah, the silver, the cloak, and the bar of gold, his sons and daughters, his ox, donkey, and sheep, his tent, and all that he had, and brought them up to the valley of Achor. Joshua said, "Why have you troubled us? Today the Lord will trouble you." So all Israel stoned them to death. They burned their bodies, threw stones on them, and raised over him a large pile of rocks that remains to this day. Then the Lord turned from his burning anger. Therefore, that place is called the Valley of Achor to this day. It's a lot of reading. God's answer to Joshua's question, why? Why did we lose the battle of Ai, was really quite simple. They lost their battle because there was sin in their camp. Look again at verse 11. And by the way, this is God speaking. "Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant that I appointed for them. They have taken some of what was set apart. They have stolen, deceived, and put the things with their own belongings." Now, as you recall, as we read, one of the Israelite men, a guy by the name of Achan, had ignored God's command to leave everything behind in Jericho, and he had taken some of the things that were set apart for destruction and put them among his own belongings. So God removed his blessing from the camp, and consequently, the Israelite army failed in its mission. It simply lacked the power of God that it had held when it prevailed over Jericho. Achan was eventually forced to confess his sin, and he was ultimately taken along with his family, all of his flocks and herds, and was stoned and burned, after which time, verse 26 tells us, the Lord turned from his burning anger. Now that is an amazing story, to say the least. And you know what? It's one that really highlights the potency of sin. And not only that, but it also debunks or busts at least three myths surrounding sin, which is what I'd like to focus in on with the rest of my time this morning. So from this point forward, folks, we all are myth busters, all right? We are myth busters. The first myth debunked or busted by this sordid story is that one little sin won't hurt. I imagine that Achan thought that his sin was so small and so insignificant and so infrequent, it was a one-time event, by the way, after all, that it just wouldn't be that big of a deal and that it would likely go unnoticed. I think Achan believed his act to be of no real consequence, that his one little sin wouldn't hurt anything. But the truth is that one little sin does hurt. In fact, often the little sins are more problematic than the big sins. When asked to tell of the biggest hurdle he faced in his walk from New York City to San Francisco, one man who accomplished this rare achievement, and I'm not talking about Forrest Gump, mentioned a rather surprising difficulty. He said that the toughest part of the trip wasn't negotiating the steep slopes of the mountains or crossing the hot, dry, and barren stretches of the desert. Instead, he said, the thing that came the closest to defeating me was the sand in my shoes. Do you ever get that little pebble, that little tiny stone in your shoe, and it drives you crazy until you can finally sit down, take off your shoe, dump it out, put the shoe back on? It's aggravating, isn't it? It's aggravating. The little sins do hurt, even the one-time little sins. Consider Adam and Eve, for instance, who brought death to the entire human race with a single little sin, Genesis chapter 3. Consider Moses, who forfeited entering the promised land on account of one little sin, Numbers chapter 20. And then there's Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, who died by fire because of a solitary little transgression, Numbers 26. And let's not forget about Uzzah, who died instantly for improperly touching the Ark of the Covenant, just once, 2 Samuel 6. And then there's Ananias and Sapphira, who were struck down for their one-time lie to the Holy Spirit. Isn't it funny how we try to justify sin by passing it off as just a little sin or as merely a single serving sin, something we've only committed a single time? When we do that, we assert a belief that our God judges sin only in large amounts or in great frequency. As long as our sin is small, that is, according to our standards or according to the world's standard, as long as we've only committed it once or maybe even twice, because that's not that much, and we try hard not to enjoy it, that it won't bother God. But it will, and it does bother God. And to explain why, let me ask you a simple question. This is for the married folks in the room. Would it bother you if your spouse cheated on you just once? I mean, can you imagine him or her trying to justify his or her actions by saying to you, come on, lighten up, honey. It was only one time and I really didn't enjoy it all that much. Would it bother you? Of course it would bother you. And all sin, big sin, little sin, one-time sin, ongoing sin, all of it bothers God because every time we sin, we cheat on God, whether it seems that way or not. That's something we forget quite often, isn't it? When we sin, it's not against some impersonal moral code or even against other people for that matter, at least not primarily. Each and every time we sin against God. When Joseph was tempted by Potiphar's wife, he didn't say to her, no, 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 I just couldn't do that. I couldn't possibly disrespect your husband and my boss that way. He didn't say that. This is what he said, Genesis 39:9. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? In confessing his indiscretion with Bathsheba, David didn't say to God, I'm really sorry. I'm so sorry for sinning against this woman and against her husband Uriah. He didn't say that at all. This is what he said, Psalm 51:4, against you, God, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Every time that we commit an offense, it's God whom we offend. And there's no such thing as offending God just a little bit because our sin is small or because it's just a one-time occurrence. If we offend God, he's offended, period. James puts it like this in James 2:10. He says, for the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. So myth number one, one little sin won't hurt. Busted. It's busted. The second myth about sin that's shot down by our story is that my sin doesn't affect anyone but me. Even though Achan clearly didn't think it would, his sin nevertheless affected people other than himself. All Israel, first of all, was rebuked by God. Look at chapter 7, verse 1 of Joshua. The Israelites, however, were unfaithful. Notice it wasn't just Achan who was unfaithful, right? Rather, all of Israel was. The Israelites were unfaithful regarding the things set apart for destruction. Achan, son of Carmi, son of Zabdi, son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took some of what was set apart, and the Lord's anger burdened against Achan? No, it doesn't say that. It says that his anger burned against the Israelites. So all of Israel was rebuked by God. Because of Achan's sin, 36 of his countrymen died, which in turn meant that 36 mothers lost their sons, and 36 wives lost their husbands, and 36 sets of children lost their fathers. Because of Achan's sin, his own sons and daughters, verse 24, along with his ox and his donkey and his sheep, all lost their lives. Because of Achan's sin, the nation of Israel suffered defeat and experienced very deep discouragement. Not only did 36 of his countrymen die as a result of Achan's sin, the remaining 2,900 plus were pushed back in defeat. And Joshua 7:5b says the people's hearts melted and they became like water. My life, my choice is the mantra of our society today, isn't it? It's the prevailing belief that I can do whatever I want to do. If I mess up, it's on me. It's my problem, so back off. We'll try to tell that to the thousands of people who lost billions of dollars, some their entire retirement fund in Ponzi schemes over the years, perpetrated by single, greedy, unethical investors, most notably Bernie Madoff back in 2009. Just ask the 13,000 people killed at the hands of a drunk driver and to the 1 million plus babies aborted in our country just last year. And try to tell that to the countless number of people affected by the recent moral failure of Dr. Stephen Lawson, the lead pastor of Trinity Bible Church of Dallas and the dean of the D-Min studies at the Master's Seminary, and by the not-so-distant moral failure of the world-renowned apologist Ravi Zacharias. As far as that goes, try to tell that to all Christians everywhere. And that's because the moral failure on part of pastors and church leaders is damaging not only to specific congregations or to specific ministries, it's harmful to the entire church. It hurts every one of us, and it's so incredibly tragic. We human beings are not nearly as independent as we think we are, or as we might want to be. We are very much interconnected, and we are very much interdependent. Very rarely, and maybe never, do our actions have absolutely no impact on at least one person, if not on several people. So myth number two, My sin doesn't affect anyone but me. Once again, say it with me. Busted. See, we're all Mythbusters, aren't we? The third and final myth about sin that is dismantled by our story is, I can keep my sin hidden. Achan apparently thought that a hole in the ground in the darkness of his tent would be enough to hide his transgression. Silly Achan, right? Upon being singled out as the guilty party, Achan confessed to Joshua, and this is verses 20 and 21 if you want to follow along. It is true, I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. This is what I did. When I saw among the spoils a beautiful cloak from Babylon, 200 silver shekels, and a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. You can see for yourself. And then he talks about his effort to conceal. They're concealed in the ground inside my tent with the money under the cloak. The problem with Achan's effort to conceal the loot here is that no matter how deep the hole or how good the cover over it, you just cannot hide your sin from God. You can't do it. We've been trying to do that, yet failing from the very beginning of time. After eating the fruit of the one tree that they were told not to eat from, and then coming under conviction for it, and then hearing God coming their way, Genesis chapter 3, verse 8 tells us the man and his wife, and that of course is Adam and Eve, hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Didn't do them any good, did it? Genesis 3, 9 says, but the Lord God called the man and said to him, where are you? Which he said, using the words of the 17th century theologian John Gill, and I'm quoting right now, not as ignorant of the place where he was, nor of what he had done, nor of the circumstances he was in, or of the answers he would make. Rather, it shows all the reverse. That God knew where Adam was, what he had done, and in what condition he was, and therefore it was in vain to seek to hide himself. End quote. Now, lest we get too hard on Adam here, let's be honest, admit that we too at times think that in our sin, we're pulling one over on God, or that he really doesn't care about that sin. But we're not, and he most certainly does care. The truth of the matter is that we can never hide our sin from God. In fact, we can't hide anything from God. Hebrews 4:13 tells us that no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Furthermore, not only can we never hide our sin from God, we very often fail to hide it from other people. Remember when Moses killed the Egyptian whom he witnessed beating a Hebrew? This goes back to Exodus 2. He didn't think anybody knew about it. He thought it was done in secret. But the very next day, he found out that he was known as a murderer. We need to keep in mind that our sins will very likely find us out, or as Moses put it in Numbers 32:23, and this comes from the Message paraphrase, but if you don't do what you say, you will be sinning against God. You can be sure that your sin will track you down. Love the way Eugene Peterson puts that. A drunken husband snuck quietly up the stairs one night. He looked in the bathroom mirror and bandaged the bumps and bruises he had received in a fight earlier that night. He then proceeded to climb into bed, smiling at the thought he'd pulled one over on his wife. When morning came, he opened his eyes, and there she stood. You were drunk last night, weren't you? Oh no, honey, I wasn't drunk. He says, well, if you weren't, then who put all the band-aids on the bathroom mirror? You got that quicker than I thought you would. Put more seriously, though, okay? If you drink too much, some, if not many people, will know you as a drunk. If you have a habit of talking disparagingly about others, some, if not many, will know you as a gossip. And if you mess around with somebody behind your spouse's back, some, if not many, will know you as an adulterer. Myth number three, I can keep my sin hidden. Once again, say it with me, please. Busted. Busted. Sin is toxic. It's poisonous. There's no such thing as little inconsequential sins, and there's no such thing as sins that have absolutely no impact on anyone else, and there's no way that we can successfully keep our sins hidden, especially from God. So then what do we do about it? What do we do about sin? Let me offer you four things, I believe we should do about sin, then I'll be done, right? Number one, we need to do all that we can to steer clear of sin. That is not to sin. Because we're all sinners at birth, and because even though we're redeemed, the sin nature is still a part of us and will be to one degree or another until we're in glory with Jesus, a lot of Christians just kind of give in to sin. They come to the conclusion that they really have no choice but to sin, at least to some extent. And since they're destined to sin, and since God's grace will cover over them when they do, they figure, why fight it? Why fight it? And worse than that, there are some churches that actually condone and even promote this cheap grace attitude. But the problem with that cheap grace attitude is that it does not jive with what the scriptures teach. Yes, we are saved by grace through faith and not by our good works. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. But we are saved for good works. And those good works serve as evidence of true faith. James chapter 2, verse 17. And that's why Paul wrote what he did in Romans chapter 6, verses 15 through 18. Listen, he says, what then? Are we to sin because we're not under law but under grace? Then he answers his own question, by no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin which leads to death or of obedience which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. Did you catch that? We have been set free from sin, which means that as believers, we don't have to sin. We are not destined to sin, and that means that we should fight the temptation to sin. It means that we should store up God's word in our hearts that we might not sin against him, Psalm 119:11. It means that we should pray every single day that God would deliver us from evil, Matthew 6:13, and that he would make clear to us the way of escape, that his promise would accompany our every temptation we face, that we may be able to endure those temptations, 1 Corinthians 10:13. We need to do our very best in the strength that the Holy Spirit provides to not sin against God. That's number one. Number two, when we do sin, we need to make sure that we confess it and that we label it appropriately, kind of like the poison in our opening story. Now I realize it sounds like I'm talking out of both sides of my mouth. We don't have to sin, yet we do have to sin. But I'm really not. What I'm saying is this. Even though we're not destined to sin, and so we should strive not to sin, the unfortunate reality is that we will slip and fall once in a while, and that's because although we can and should experience improvement or growth on this side of heaven, and that's because we have the Holy Spirit living and working within us, we won't experience perfection until we're glorified and in heaven when we stand face to face with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So when we do slip and fall, we need to make sure that we don't soft pedal and invariably justify our sin, because if we do that, we're just going to stay in it. We're just going to become desensitized to it. Rather, we need to confess it and boldly call it what it is. It is a grievous offense against Almighty God. We need to be sure that we confess our sin and to label it appropriately. Number three, we need to repent of our sin and ask for and receive God's forgiveness. After we've confessed our sin and labeled it appropriately, we need to, as quickly as possible, repent of it. That is, turn from it. so that we don't suffer under the heavy hand of God as King David did by refusing to repent of his sin for nearly a year. As a result, he said, and this is in Psalm 32, verses 3 and 4, that his bones wasted away through his groaning all day long, and his strength was dried up as in the heat of summer. We need to, without delay, repent of our sin, to offer to God, as David eventually did, Psalm 51, 17, the sacrifice that is pleasing to him, which is a broken or repentant or contrite heart. And we need to ask God for his forgiveness and his restoration. David actually pleaded with God in Psalm 51, first two verses, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." And last but not least, we need to receive and boldly claim that forgiveness in light of the promise in God's word, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Number four, last but not least, we need to call each other out on sin. And this is where we help each other out in this area. We call each other out. Many Christians really struggle with this. They'll refer to Jesus' words in Matthew 7, 4, where he says, "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when there is a log in your own eye?" They'll go on to say, based on what Jesus said, "I have no right to point out someone else's sin because I have my own sin issues." But what they're missing is the context. What Jesus said on either side of Matthew 7, 4. What he said in verse 3 and what he said in verse 5. Here's verse 3. "Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eyes, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye?" Then he gets to verse 4. Or, so he's going to rephrase that. "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when there's a log in your own eye?" And then he decimates it in verse 5. He says, "You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eyes." Furthermore, Jesus said very plainly to his disciples in Luke 17, 3, "If your brother sins, rebuke him. Call him out on it." And contrary to what some people will contend, this is not about judging the heart of our brother and sister. That's not our job. That's Jesus' job. This is about humbly and lovingly pointing out his or her sinful behavior and doing so for his or her benefit. And along with that pointing out, comes the unspoken invitation to kindly reciprocate when necessary. This is just what we do for each other. So once again, real quickly, we need to do our best to not sin, to steer clear of sin. Secondly, when we do, we need to confess it. We need to label it appropriately. Thirdly, we need to repent of it. We need to turn away from it and seek God's forgiveness. And lastly, we need to help each other out in the body by calling each other out on our sin. So in conclusion, and before I do this, worship team, come back up, please. I'm almost done. Hi, Greg. In conclusion, let me say this. Sermons about sin are not very popular. They're not particularly fun to preach, and they're not particularly fun to hear preached. I get that. But they're very, very important. Avoiding the issue of sin might make for a milder label, but it will also make for a deadlier poison. And because, unlike the church leader in my opening story, we, the leaders here at Harvest, want to protect you from this poison, we have to and we will put an accurate label on it. We will always call sin what it is. Sin is a grievous offense against Almighty God. We will always encourage you to the best of your ability and in God's strength to steer clear of sin, to be holy because God is holy, 1 Peter 1:16. And when you slip and fall, we will always gently call you out on your sin and we will always direct you back to the loving arms of your gracious, forgiving Heavenly Father. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. Thank you for teaching us about sin. Father, we recognize that we're redeemed. Those of us who have put our faith in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins, we're redeemed. We're heirs of you. We're adopted children. We're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. But we also know that we struggle with that sin nature. It's frustrating to us. We don't want to sin. Maybe I should say we don't want to sin. I pray that you give us new hearts, give us pure hearts. But help us to understand that we are going to slip and fall. And we need to be very quick to confess our sin, to label it appropriately, to repent of it, to turn away from it, to seek your forgiveness. And then based on the promise that you give us in your word, receive that forgiveness, embrace that forgiveness, and pray for strength to do better. So I'm not preaching about legalism here. This is not a legalism sort of sermon, but this is something that we need to do as children of God. We need to have this desire in our hearts to be holy because you're holy. So help us. We cannot do that in our own strength. So be our strength. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand. Let's continue to worship God.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold. Fire.
Called in Scripture to be holy because God is holy. I think the temptation to sin is the temptation to chase after our happiness. And therefore, it feels like chasing after holiness sounds like a drag because happiness is over here. But the truth of the matter is there's where true joy is. We chase after holiness. We purify our lives, and we're holy as God is holy. Then the happiness, the real heart level, deep joy and happiness comes as a result of that holiness that we've opted for. If you need prayer, we have folks sprinkled throughout the congregation that have lanyards that, with a yellow tag in it, says prayer partner. Seek out one of those. I imagine some of them will probably come up here, but you don't have to come up to pray. You can find somebody that will pray with you. Maybe there's a sin issue you want to help. Have someone help you with. We'd be happy to do that with you. God bless you. Go with you throughout this week.